fascinating conference has just been held here in South Africa at the University of the Witwatersrand. It dealt with the universe in general, and in particular, the material spread between the stars. We used to think that space was empty, and there was absolute emptiness between our galaxy and the next. Well, this is quite wrong. Of course, we can see bright clouds of gas and dust in space. We call them nebulae. And something like 5,000 million years ago, our sun was born inside one of these nebulae. We can also see galaxies, huge systems of stars, so far away that their light, traveling at 186,000 miles per second, takes millions, or hundreds of millions, or even thousands of millions of years to reach us. But we also believe that there's a tremendous amount of dark matter which we can't see at all. And up to now, the nature of this dark matter has been very much of a mystery. One of the main organizers of the conference was Professor David Block. First, David, what was the main purpose of the conference?
Patrick, the conference has been a highly exciting international event, and the main point was simply this, the probing of cold and very cold cosmic dust grains.
There are 100,000 million stars in our galaxy and a great deal of interstellar material. We know about the bright nebulae, we can see those, but what about the dark nebulae?
Well, this is what's so terribly intriguing, Patrick. In our own Milky Way galaxy, as you correctly point out, we've got 100,000 million stars. And coal dust, the effects of dust, such as the beautiful Horsehead Nebula, one can see so clearly, or the magnificent Southern Coal Sack, you can see that there are regions of sky which are apparently empty. But we recall that the American astronomer Edwin Barnard had photographed these magnificent dark nebulae, these apparent holes, which when you look through them with infrared telescopes, show up dust in all their glory and splendor. But cold dust had never ever been discovered in galaxies outside of our Milky Way. And this was the key question. Did cold dust exist in other galaxies or not? And this became a focus of research worldwide. And I was very privileged to be invited by the director of the European Southern Observatory in Chile to actually go to Chile and head up a team of astronomers to almost be on a detective trail. Does coal dust actually exist on a vast cosmic scale or does it not? And the exciting findings, of course, of this conference is that coal dust is found everywhere amongst the myriads of galaxies which fill intergalactic space.
What have you discovered about the dark lanes in our galaxy and others?
Up to the present time, Patrick, if we recall photographs of famous galaxies such as NGC 2997, we remember that dust lanes were always confined to the spiral arms of a galaxy. Whenever we looked at photographs of galaxies, we saw the dust lanes in the spiral arms, delineating the spiral arms of the galaxy, but we were never ever able to see dust between the arms of spiral galaxies. And I shall never forget that magic moment. I was actually in Chile observing with one of the famous telescopes, and it was absolutely amazing. I was using highly sophisticated near-infrared sensors, and I was imaging galaxy after galaxy. Then I flew back to Germany, and suddenly I was using very sophisticated techniques when suddenly I saw very, very clearly that dust was not only confined to the dust lanes or the spiral arms of a galaxy, but cosmic dust was a universal phenomenon. In fact, we could actually see dust grains between the arms of spiral galaxies. And Patrick, what was so amazing is not only were these dust grains there, but we were looking at 2,000 million tons of organic material per galaxy. It was literally looking at the blueprints, at the cosmic blueprints for life, 10 million solar masses worth of it per galaxy, sprawled over the entire face of each galaxy.
So you found coal dust grains in galaxies. What does this tell us about the nature and evolution of the galaxies?
I think this is a terribly important question. What it tells us is that dust grains are very, very effective hosts for gas atoms and molecules to condense upon. For example, we might think of organic compounds which are actually frozen solid on these dusty grains. And Patrick, this has got This signals tremendous significance for life in our cosmos, because if we think of our own solar system, the most famous star in our sky, the Sun, formed by the collapse under gravity of a dusty cloud of gas and of dust. And so what this really signals in astrophysics is the fact that there are tremendous amounts of organic material in these galaxies. Our Milky Way, therefore, is by no means unique in hosting millions upon millions upon millions of tons of organic matter. It works like this, Patrick. Just like frost condenses on a glass pane in winter, so these cold interstellar molecules, these molecules containing carbon and other materials, actually freeze on these cold dust grains. That's why they are so cold. And without these dust grains, you and I would not be here at this interview. Because, to quote Professor Robert Dickey at Princeton University, it is well known that carbon is required to make physicists.
And this is the first time it's actually been detected.
Patrick, this is the first time ever in the history of astronomy that coal dust has been detected optically. It had been detected in our galaxy, as I've said before, but never before optically in other galaxies. This is a first for our team, and we are thrilled and absolutely delighted.
Well, many congratulations. Now, quite apart from the dark matter we can see because of its obscuring properties, what about the dark matter we can't see at all?
Well, this is, of course, a very, very enigmatic question and issue. Is there dark matter out there? Because some astronomers postulate that approximately 90% of matter in our cosmos is unseen, lurking in the form of this enigmatic dark matter. And of course, astronomers, as you know, through the ages, have postulated different constituent components of this dark matter. Some astronomers have said that it's black holes. Others have postulated that it might be these enigmatic neutrinos. But what is terribly interesting, what emerged from this conference, is that the dark matter might consist of very cold hydrogen gas. As was discussed at this conference by Dr. Coombs, Feniger, Lecure, and others, galaxies might be surrounded, Patrick, by vast halos of very cold dust, and gas, hydrogen gas. And of course, this makes perfectly good sense, because you've got a proto-galaxy which then collapses to form your galaxy. There's obviously a lot of gas and dust left over, and it makes sense to postulate that a lot of the dark matter might be in the form of cold hydrogen gas and dust. For example, the one reason why I do not believe that dark matter is in the form of black holes is black holes, of course, are gregarious creatures by nature. They gobble up more and more and more gas and dust, and we would see gas floating or being dragged in gravitationally to the halos, into the halos of our galaxy, which we don't. Everything, when we look at our Milky Way galaxy, when we look at the halos of other galaxies, everything looks perfectly normal and quiet out there. And so I am of the opinion, and of course, as I said, emerges a key issue of the conference, is that cold gas might form a very, very vital point of this enigmatic dark matter. Dark matter, which might constitute 90% of the mass in our universe and yet is totally invisible to the naked eye.
There has been a great deal of talk about this cold dark matter being something exotic we can't detect at all by any means, or I take it you don't go along with that.
Well, this is the whole point. I believe that dark matter might be very clearly explained in terms, without invoking black holes or other enigmatic objects. For example, simple interstellar constituents such as gas and dust and hydrogen gas. We think of our own Big Bang, the primordial Big Bang, and consisting so much of hydrogen gas that some of this hydrogen gas obviously gets left when galaxies are formed, and it's very, very cold. We estimate, Patrick, that some of the gas molecules are at a temperature of minus 250 degrees centigrade, which is a mere 20 degrees above absolute zero, which is the temperature at which all molecular motion stops. So it's very, very cold. You cannot see it ordinarily with a naked eye, but it is there. Just like the coal dust grains, we cannot see them using ordinary techniques, but they are there.
What does all this tell us about the future evolution of the universe itself? It must make quite a difference.
Patrick, indeed, our universe might now not expand forever, but if there is enough cold gas and cold dust out there, what this could herald is the collapse, not tomorrow, I'm happy to say, but the collapse in billions of years' time of our ever-expanding cosmos. At the moment when I gaze through the giant eyes of the Hawaiian telescopes, we see that our universe is expanding. Galaxies are receding from us moment by moment. But a very important point of this conference is that there might be enough cold gas out there to halt the future expansion of our cosmos, and eventually the Big Bang would stop expanding, a collapse would ensue, and that would mark the end of our cosmos, but happily not tomorrow.
Well, you've detected dust grains now in galaxies. Now, what about dust grains in between groups of galaxies?
This, of course, is also a very, very important point. Are there dust grains between galaxies? And the answer really is, which emerged from this conference, we really don't know. We don't have limits as to how much dust there now is. We know it's all over the place. It's between the arms of spiral galaxies. But the point is, the only reason we can see them between the arms of galaxies is because there's light from background stars. Now, intergalactic space is very, very cold, perhaps just a few degrees above absolute zero in some cases. And we do not now know how much dust there is. But one thing we are sure of, coal dust is here to stay.
Well, you've made the great breakthrough by detecting it optically for the first time. What comes next in the research?
Of course, the European, the satellite, the infrared astronomical satellite ISO has just been launched. And I believe what comes next in the research is probing this coal dust through the eyes of the International Space Observatory ISO. I believe that ISO now will supplement what we have found optically. It will show us through the eyes of the infrared sensors just how widespread this cold dust is as a cosmic phenomenon.
I agree that space research is of fundamental importance, but after all, there's still a great deal to be done from the ground.
Absolutely. My team of collaborators will be applying for telescope time. We'll be looking through the eyes of the Hawaiian telescopes, and I predict that as our team of investigators proceeds, we will find that coal dust is truly a cosmic phenomenon which heralds the cosmic blueprints for life from galaxy to galaxy to galaxy and yet to myriads of galaxies beyond.
How does this research link in with the results from COBE, the Cosmic Background Explorer satellite?
Patrick, at this conference we've been very privileged to have John Mather here, who is known as Mr. COBE, of course. He gave a fascinating talk on how our early Big Bang was bathed in very, very hot radiation, which has now become very cold. And I think the beautiful link-up between my findings and the COBE findings is that a lot of radiation in our presently expanding Big Bang cosmos is very cold. The very, very hot radiation from the primordial, primeval Big Bang has now cooled off to around 3 degrees Kelvin. The coal dust which we are finding is only about 10 degrees hotter. So what it does really show is a lot of our cosmos is very, very cold. And of course, stars are born in these very, very cold interiors. Stellar maternity wards are really the locales of very, very cold gas and dust molecules. And so in that sense, I believe there's the most beautiful bridge, as Dr. Mather pointed out, between the COBE results, very, very cold radiation, and very, very cold dust as the building blocks of life in our cosmos.
Obviously, you can't make the actual observations here in Johannesburg. I gather most of it's done from Hawaii.
Absolutely. We travel all the time to Hawaii, to Chile, to other observatories. We need to use infrared sensors, Patrick, infrared cameras. And so we go to sites like Mauna Kea in Hawaii, where it is very high, 14,000 feet up, the world's highest observatory, almost airborne as it were, and from there the air is so dry, so clear, so pristine that you can use these infrared sensors to actually probe the dusty domains of galaxies. And then I bring back the data, and this is what's so exciting. The photons which I store, which I capture, have been traveling in some instances for 60 million years or more. And you know what's so exciting is I take them, store them on digital tape, which is smaller than this, and it fits into my shirt pocket, and then I fly back to this observatory, to this laboratory over here, and this is where I do my analysis. This is where I sit behind my computer to actually probe the interstellar domains of what exists between the arms of spiral galaxies.
Well, of course, Earth-based telescopes are being improved all the time. What do you hope to get out of the new 8-meter telescope being planned for Hawaii and others like it? How's that going to help you?
I think that we can expect absolutely stunning images from the 8-meter telescope. What this really means is the bigger the telescope, the further we can look. And so with the 8-meter, for example, I believe that we will secure the most stunning shots of galaxies. And of course, it's going to revolutionize astronomy because up to now, every galaxy, the dust, is delineated or constricted to the spiral arms of a galaxy. And as you can see so clearly now, this cosmic dust is everywhere. And so I believe that with the 8-meter and other telescopes, we will find that astronomers up to now have not been able to see a constituent which is absolutely vital for cosmic evolution and for our existence, cold grains, 20 degrees above absolute zero.
We've certainly come a long way. After all, when I was born, we didn't know definitely that the galaxies were galaxies. It was thought they might be minor parts of our own Milky Way system. What do you think are going to be the next fundamental discoveries in this research?
Let us hope. Let us hope that we can find a chance alignment of one galaxy in front of another galaxy. In other words, emitting light. And let us hope that with the 8-meter and other telescopes that we can actually detect cold, dusty halos around galaxies. That truly would be revolutionary. I believe there's no more to be discovered in terms of cold, very cold dust. There's a lot to build upon, but I think that the temperatures of dust are warm, cold, and very cold. We hope to build, but of course one can never predict for sure. This is the joy of modern astronomy.
David, could you sum up the key results of this conference?
I think the key concept which emerged from this conference is the tremendous importance of something which constitutes 90% of the mass and yet had never been seen before. It's as if you've got a glass filled with marbles, 10 marbles, and astronomers up to now have only seen one marble. And we now are proud at the University of the Witwatersrand to have discovered the other 9 out of 10.
Certainly, the conference has been a great success. This is all new information, and it may well be that we are at last starting to understand the nature of this mysterious dark matter. Don't forget, if you want the latest astronomical information, then call up our SkyNight information line, 0891 800330, or you can dial up CFAX page 615. And when we come back next month, we'll be talking about the results from the latest spacecraft. Until then, good night.